I just wanted to see you play woodblock.
This first piece, I'm very flattered, is dedicated to me by Louis Andriessen, and it's called Woodpecker. And he dedicated it to me, I think. In fact, he commissioned it. It's one of these lucky commissions where someone else commissioned it, and I got the dedication without having to go through any rigmarole of my money for him. So it was commissioned by a Dutch percussion competition, which took place last October, and I don't remember the name of it, so I don't have to look down. But anyway, this was the set piece on that competition, so which kind of made me scratch my head because the blocks were so difficult to come by, tuned properly, that I just thought, man, how are all these people going to find the right blocks to participate in this competition? But I guess they came close. So the reason that the connection to me is that Louis was a guest professor at Princeton University, a composition professor, about maybe 4 years ago for a whole semester. We were just happening to have him in town and have lots of social occasions and dinners with him. And he and his wife are big bird lovers and had never heard a woodpecker before. So then there's a lot of woodpeckers in the woods in Princeton. So, you know, he was very, very taken with this woodpecker sound. And I was starting to pester him at the time to write me a piece. So we had a couple of sessions where he came to my practice room and he was playing around with muted things, like put a towel down and try very fast things. And he was sort of starting to fish with this woodpecker concept. Didn't end up doing anything with the kids, but my assignment, right when he left Princeton, was to go and find every recording I could of North American woodpeckers and send them to him, which I did. I went to the biology lab at Princeton and sent him his tape. And so I think the connection is with Princeton and me and the woodpecker. So about a year later, I found these blocks, which I just played for Danny, and they're supposed to be tuned. These are Muksho that Michael Udall made, and temple blocks. And all these wood blocks are kind of low for wood block pitches, and the temple blocks, some of these are kind of high for temple block pitches, so it was really a pain in the neck to try to find the right blocks, and it literally took me a year. And lots and lots of, because Louis really wanted them to look like authentic, you know, red-painted Chinese temple blocks, like how it looked was very important to him. But everything was played forte, and so I contacted people that had the authentic Chinese temple blocks, and they said no, but they'll break within the day, and, you know, fun. So I had to finally compromise on all Louis' requirements and what would possibly stand up to be needed. And so it was frustrating because this music was literally sitting on my shelf for a year before I could begin to play through it. And I wrote Louis a note at one point that sounded kind of apprehensive, I think, about I'm finally going to get into this piece. And he wrote me back. I've actually never read this to anybody, but I hang this on my bulletin board in the practice room. It makes me smile every time I saw it, so I thought I'd read it to you today. He wrote me back a postcard and said, "Don't forget, do not worry too much about it. You are simply a bunch of woodpeckers. They cannot read music. Make it sound strange and crazy, not as a conservatory teacher." So I sent this to a friend of mine in Holland, Peter Prommel. Peter wrote back, "Louis is crazy and likes to make people think about what they do and stir them up a bit. If you were a woodpecker," he would say, this Louis to the woodpecker who plays a marimba piece, "don't forget, do not worry too little about it. You should simply be like a bunch of marimba players. They can read music, make it sound smooth and glossy, like a conservatory teacher." So, this was all part of the fun of learning this piece. I then had a coaching which Peter set up in Holland for me last September. And because it was going to be in this competition and nobody was supposed to get any leg up on learning the piece over other people that could be there, this whole session was very carefully documented that made public to everybody that was learning a piece for the competition, to be very fair. And so, you know, great to get to play with him. And he had two musical thoughts about the piece, which are the last things I'll tell you before I get going here. One was that he was inspired, as he wrote it, by children's games and how when we make up games as kids, we just make up ludicrous rules sometimes, but we're very steadfast about them, and that's okay. And so he just sort of had some fun rules for himself as he composed this. And the other thing was that he was thinking about the conversations that woodpeckers have. You know, we hear one pecking on a tree over there, one pecking on a tree over there, and they start to seem like they're listening and responding to each other. And then he asked the question, you know, are they responding to each other, or do we only imagine that they're responding to each other? So there's all the background I can give you on woodpecker.
Thank you. specify rubber mallets?
Oh, he specified leather mallets.
Leather, is that what?
Leather covered mallets, so.
And what's inside?
I don't know, but I think they're similar to my mallets inside. Like the guy
so
numbered them.
Latex.
Yeah, I think it's a lot of, you know, maybe
cool.
a hard plastic core, and then latex because he numbered them after my series. So.
Shot.
Yeah,
pretty
but
good shot.
Isn't that awesome?
And it's there's nothing, there's like no low register in it at all.
Yeah. Except those couple of beat blasts.
Right.
And not even much of a section till the end, it's just marimba.
Right.
So yeah,
he's right.
thinking of the marimba as a cyclical block.
Right. So he's trying to write a marimba piece by avoiding the marimba.
Thank you.
lot of other players approach to group sections. Like, I'm not by any means exactly doing what he's, the way he plays it. I mean, it's transcribed, and then, you know, kind of listen and get his take and do your own thing. I mean, it would take a lot to transcribe exactly all the little drunken things that he does. But, you know, like, instead of... Japanese woman, Akemi Naito, who's lived in New York. Does anybody know her? I think she's lived here about 10 years. And this was commissioned by Alan Zimmerman for a new music marimba and for Bill as a gift. And it's called Memory of the Woods.
Thank you.
Anything you want to ask me about? Talk about it?
I want to ask you a question. But you probably cover this when you coach the guys, but I'm just going to throw it out there so you can start with it. Can you talk a little about roles? Because I assume that all those different roles you're doing are not notated, correct? Mm-hmm. In this particular piece.
Right.
So can you talk a little bit about your philosophy about different kinds of roles and how you chose when? Because there was a lot happening. And role speed and things like that.
I think probably what was happening there was mostly about roles. Because I don't really think about different configurations of roles.
Yeah.
My basic role is, which is a rhythm role, and actually what's technically happening is, so the outside of each hand hits first, but I never practiced it this way. I never practiced. You know, I hit and then the ripple roll starts. So I do that all the time.
it's important for everyone to notice when she says, it's just one of my things, and I talk to them a lot. When she says that she varies her roll speed, she really varies her roll speed.
Yeah.
Yeah, like not 10%.
Yeah, you know, actually one of the things...
Sounds great, that's what I'm just saying, because it's a color thing.
I really believe that, you know, roles, we can look at like a handicap or a virtue, but, you know, on one hand we feel kind of embarrassed that, you know, sorry we don't have the pedal and we have to give you this blow that we're looking for you to have sustain, but I feel like you could also turn that around, and I think of this as my vibrato, and I really love, like, when I hear, you know, a very sax player play a jazz ballad, and at the end they're holding the last note, and you hear that air in their throat, and it kind of catches on their throat, there's all these accidents in it, and that's, like, a beautiful moment when you're coming out of the ballad, because you go, oh, this is the humanness of this air, you know? And so I really love how one of the things you can really do on the marimba is beautiful messiness, you know, that is very expressive somehow. Yeah.
How do you feel with the piece, which is the mellow?
About different stroke speeds, and how that enables me to make different articulations. I guess my general tone production idea is like really into the bar. It's like my just basic strokes are really into the bar, almost. Actually, if I had to just strike one note for you, I'll tell you what I would think if I had to just make the nicest sound I could with one stroke. I imagine I'm not only gonna hit the surface, but I'm gonna scoop in like another quarter of an inch into the bar where I can't really go. And then I also kind of have this superstition, I think it does something, that if I'm trying to make a really fat tone, if I hover over the bar after I make the stroke, instead of just coming back up, that it actually makes the note sound longer, like I feel like I'm trapping the resonance. This is something I've sort of tried to play with in terms of that other limitation we have, that, you know, oh, this is a marimba. We have eighth notes, we have quarter notes, we have whole notes, you know, and they all kind of look the same. You know, sometimes you can do something physical to telegraph the difference between that. Like, marimbology. We talked about this one. Third movement ends. That last note's an eighth note. And Gunther and I talked about if the tempo is this, like I shouldn't be there an eighth note's worth. And I shouldn't do anything else. Like, you know, something, you know, because in this case I've got a tuning that looked like an eighth note. So I think there's more to it than just making it look that way though sometimes. That actually if I had to make this in the same tempo we were at, somehow I feel like if I stay there, I can kind of convince you it's a half note, you know? And I hear something different with the resonance when I'm trapping it there than if I do this. I hear a difference here. I don't know what it goes on to. But, you know, I almost feel like, you know, whether or not you can hear the difference, it affects the dance of how you play. And on this instrument, you kind of can't avoid, you know, it's very important how you move around, I think, too. I'm not one at all to, like, you know, plan out my dance stroke, the dance steps whatsoever, but, you know, it's a big instrument to breathe with and embrace and just walk around. And I think those kinds of things like note durations and attacks are kind of all part of how you move the instrument.
How conscious is your compensation when you play like a single line between your graduated notes? And is that something that you worked really hard to develop or just sort of?
it's fairly conscious. It depends on how exposed the line is. Sometimes, like something like this, I think that doesn't break the line too much to switch. But I'm also thinking about coming into this next note, the first one with the slightly harder mallet, with a gentler kind of wolfier stroke, which I may be molding quite so careful with here. I'll play more normally here. But then this is the first one with this stick, but this stick is better in this register anyway. So, you know, it's kind of always balancing what sticks flatter each register the best. And yeah, definitely some strokes. If I had to play a scale, I'm consciously playing with a lot more pressure on this stick and very
developing the independence, so one mallet is not dependent on the idea that the others do. Say if you were playing a fugue and have one line going your outer mallet in your right hand and then one on the inner of your left hand, and obviously not in unison, how do you make it so if you were to take one, it would sound exactly like the line you would hear? I mean, is it just the concept in your head and then being able to
Yeah, I think it's a concept in my head, but a lot of things that are hard to put together like that, I wouldn't practice so much separately, because a lot of it is just how am I going to do this at the same time. So I need to practice it sort of slowly at the same time. But there, I think it can all be a matter of dynamic plateaus. Like if you really are playing within a certain plateau, not that it's going to be flat, but within a certain plateau on one hand, and you keep the other also even. The other, if it's really uniformly even, if it has voice of its own, here you so it's a matter of really just getting the two threads going in your head. I think that's the best I can do
right now. Yeah, I've seen you play a lot, and I don't recall ever seeing, unless I'm wrong, that you play on the tip of the mallet.
Yeah.
Is there a reason why?
Yeah, I kind of don't buy into that.
You just think it doesn't, I mean, talking about color difference.
It sounds different. Like, I came to a master class here that Bob Van Zeist did a few years ago. It was great. I mean, he talks about playing playing off the resonator, really pointedly or on, and what it does. And I just, like, I got a basic sound. I look at it more like I'm going to have my basic voice. If my preference is I like over the resonator, where, as Bob would say, it's a more complex kind of resonance. Except when I play, say, below, in the last octave, I play off-center, because there I want to get, you get a clear fundamental pitch if you're a little bit off-center. It's a little drier sound, but it's clearer F, and usually when I'm down here, it's the base of the chord, and I want to retune. I really got into this with playing with violin, so I want to be able to tune my chord to a strong fundamental. So that's just my basic thing. I always play over the middle, I play over the edges if I don't want to be, doing this all the time. Jack Anthony calls sticking the sword, pulling the sword in and out. So I want to move the least I can, and I just feel like, determine what my personal voice is. I don't want to go changing the sound. I just feel like, okay, so you want me to get softer, you'll get my good favorite basic sound, softer. I don't and I'm doing stuff with touch a lot. I want to feel like the controls in my hands, I guess, more than I want to. Yeah, this is definitely does something. It's definitely a sound. I just personally, it doesn't feel like me. I'd rather just, keep it rich and get soft. That area, I was like, sounding
potent, I guess. I just noticed that you read all these pieces, and I'm not
talk a little bit about how you go about memorizing pieces and how you feel about memorizing stuff with kids.
I don't memorize.
Yeah.
I don't ever memorize, and I think it's a shortcoming probably, and at this point I just feel like I'm too old to start memorizing. I just never had a teacher that made me memorize aside from my piano teacher when I was 8. I had to play a Bach convention in a recital at number 8, and I just sat down, it was all muscle memory, and it was really fast, and you know, I got through it, but it was like, I don't even know what happened, you know. And so I've just never memorized anything. I went straight from, you know, Bickford, who never made me memorize a learning piece, to being out playing so much contemporary music and then all the stuff with chamber music. I pretty much, you know, straight out of school was doing chamber music a lot more than solo music. I've only been doing solo performing a lot for, in the last 43 years, 3 years. So straight out of school, I just, I'm basic, there's no way to do any other way.
Right.
Yeah. yeah, so I'm in kind of an odd place with that as I find myself being a soloist.
So I mean, do you think
when you
say a piece of you, that you're really familiar with, you've been playing for years, I mean, it's the kind of thing that you just have music here and you're looking at it, but you know, just, I mean, could you just take music away and then you could probably get the piece and play it? Wow, that's great. I mean, I can't really play a room. I'm not a very good role player, so for me, it's like, yeah, I'm just going to end up memorizing this.
Why is it? Well, that's, I mean, I started this piano, so I'm very, very comfortable.
Yeah, you're really busy.
And also, I think it kind of fits in a way with my particular, most of the music that I play is very all over the instrument, very Sea of Thursday-ish. And it's, I mean, I just really gravitate toward that kind of playing, which I think really needs to feel like centered playing. You're playing so much, you know, you can't spot yourself on either end. So for me, the music is just centering. I mean, it just goes natural, but it's there. yeah, I guess I wish I could memorize, but I'm so far from being able to when it's like that.
We should hear these guys play.
Yeah.
But here's my question for you. But you started to talk about Gunther Schiller a little bit, and you've worked extensively with composers, like more than anyone. So tell us, I mean, obviously we know what they've gotten from you in terms of learning what the instrument can do and what to do and what not to do, hopefully a little bit, as we spoke about earlier. So what kinds of things have you gotten from them?
I feel like composers have been my main teachers. I think with Merlin, we probably actually coached with at least 50 composers, maybe 60 composers, and then there's been, you know, solo pieces beyond that. So I figure I've had coachings with 75 composers. You know, man, that is an education, because especially the ones that really can talk about a feeling they want in the music, or you even just get a feeling about them as people sometimes that gives you a feeling of like, oh, it gets even into articulations. Like, this guy is so funny in a certain way, he has just felt like I've, has made me feel like I have to try out so many personalities that it's just forced me to grow so much as a musician that I had to react to all those personalities. And oftentimes in pieces that, they're, you know, in doing a lot of commissioning, there's a lot of times you get a piece you don't get or you don't like, and then you meet the composer and you have to get something from this person that is going to be able to get you through the piece. That's a great learning experience too, to just feel like, what can, you know, ask every question I can think of to make this person tell me something that's going to make this piece make sense to me. And most of the time, they can, you know, so that you afterwards you go, okay, I can rationalize doing this because of their particular angle on it. I've never phrased quite this way, but I can see there could be something if I could do it. You know, so there, the, you know, I want to be forced to play different things than I would think of on my own, just to stretch me as a musician. So, yeah, just, you know, it's been incredible education.
So should we? Name of your piece.